وقيل الحمد لله. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وأصحاب سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم صلاة وسلاما عليك يا سيدي يا رسول الله وعلى آلك وأصحابك يا سيدي يا حبيب الله الحمد لله تعالى all praises to Allah سبحانه وتعالى who's given us the tawfiq and ability to gather in these blessed moments in this blessed place and I pray that Allah سبحانه وتعالى accept all of our humble efforts during this blessed month and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards all of us abundantly and grants us prosperity and success in this world and the next. The topic of today's discussion, the theme for these four lectures this year was mainly based around the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or the division that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam made between the 10 days of this month. So the first 10 days, the Prophet ﷺ told us, are the days of mercy, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's rahmah. The second 10 days are the days of maghfirah and forgiveness. And the third 10 days, they are the days of acquiring freedom from the hellfire. And so, based on that, that's the topic, the main theme for the first three lectures, and the fourth one, inshallah, how to retain the effects of Ramadan and how to continue our practices of the month of Ramadan on through the rest of the year as well. And so, just to put it into a bit of perspective in terms of our modern lives as well, the theme is not just maghfirah and forgiveness, but the theme is also, or attached to that, is this sense that it's, you know, make it a time for change. Make this the moment where this is the significant change in your life and make it happen. And so one thing which is obviously associated very closely with this topic and this whole topic is based around is forgiveness and seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because one thing that is clearly established from authentic, you know, ahadith and from the Quran, and we know from all the sources that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His mercy is boundless. And the fact that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us never to lose hope of His mercy. That was the topic of last week's discussion, that never despair from the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if that's the case, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in terms of forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ready to forgive. And it's a matter of asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness with sincerity. It's a matter of actually being sincere about wanting to make that change in your life. And inshallah we'll talk today about how you can make that change effective, things you can do to actually help you along the way in light of the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so it's about making that change, about being sincere in that change. What do I mean? Well, it's a simple example is, the greatest of all sins is what? What is Akbarul Kabair, the biggest of all sins is? It's shirk. It's associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And somebody for his entire life, he's committing this biggest of all sins, and his entire life he's associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's not believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so obviously anything else that he's doing is not worth anything to him. And then all of a sudden, towards the end of his life, he has a moment of realization, and he realizes that he's wrong. And he starts to contemplate over his errors. And just before, perhaps maybe moments before he dies, he has that moment of realization. And he realizes that he was wrong. And he seeks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he decides to become a believer. Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive that whole lifetime of shirk and being involved in this Akbarul Kabair, and this biggest of all sins, or not? Of course. So that, use that as an example, as some inspiration, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ready to forgive. Allah will forgive somebody who his entire life has committed this biggest of all sins, which is a direct violation against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And even in the last moments of his life, if that person realizes and he makes that conscious decision and he actually decides to make that change, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive him. And he'll forgive him in such a manner that that person will then have a completely clean slate. And so this is something, it's a bit of inspiration going into this topic and into this discussion. But the fact is that Imam Nawawi, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions in Riyadh al-Salihin, the second chapter in this book, the first chapter is on niyyah, on ikhlas, on sincerity, and the presence of niyyah throughout all actions and intention. And the second chapter is tawbah, it's repentance, bab al-tawbah. It's about seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because remember that forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ready to forgive. His mercy, His rahmah, His forgiveness is calling out to people. But it is upon the people to actually make the effort of doing tawbah and of seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's our responsibility. But Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he actually writes at the beginning of this chapter on tawbah, he says that the ulama have stated, at-tawbatu wajibatun min kulli dhanb. Tawbah is necessary. Repentance is necessary from every single sin. And this is why, connected to, you know, these last 10 days, the second 10 days of Ramadan, the du'as that are taught for them as well, they are based around that particular theme of those 10 days. And so the du'a for these 10 days is what? It's istighfar. Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli zambin wa atubu ilayh. But I seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all sins, and I turn to Him in repentance. And this is something that you should be reciting frequently throughout these 10 days now, up until the last 10 days, starting on the evening, the Maghrib, after the 20th fast. Right? So up until that moment, you should be reciting this excessively. You should be seeking forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But, and that's the meaning, that's the translation of those words, that I seek forgiveness from all of my sins. The ulama have said, seeking forgiveness from all your sins is necessary, it's wajib. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands in the Quran, Allah commands that you seek forgiveness from Him. And He says that if this matter is between Allah and the servant, then there's three conditions. And if it's between a person and other people, then there's one additional condition, which means there's four conditions. So three conditions for tawbah, for repentance. It's not just good enough then, you know, we've said, recite in abundance, Astaghfirullah Rabbi min kulli zambin wa atubu ilayhi, or any other words of istighfar that you know, recite them in abundance in these 10 days. Is that enough though? Is it enough just to be reciting Astaghfirullah, saying Astaghfirullah and hoping that's enough? The fact is that in order to make this change effective, you need to do certain things. And those things are extremely important. So the first condition, Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, Ahaduha, the first one is that the person should stop doing whatever sin he's involved in. Why? You can't do tawbah while you're still actively engaged in a sin. So whatever that sin is, and the fact is, you know, these three conditions, I'll go through them, and then there's something very important that I want to discuss. So the first one is, stop doing what you're doing that is wrong. You can't repent if you're still involved in sin. Wathani, the second one, that you are ashamed and embarrassed of what you've done. Again, you can't repent sincerely until you have that realization that what you've done is wrong, that you feel embarrassed about it. Wathalith, and the third one, is that you make a firm intention never to do that again. Right? So these three conditions are necessary for your tawbah to be valid. Now the fact of the matter is, one of the biggest problems, one of the, you know, the two things that we have, there's two things that stop us from making that change within our lives. It could be anything. You know, everyone knows their own state of affairs best. None of us are angels, so we're humans, we are prone to make mistakes, to go wrong. And so everyone knows their own state of affairs best. This is where it's time for you to actually reflect on your own state of affairs. What is it? What is your issue? What is it that you actually need to walk away from? Where's the changing that needs to happen in your lives? Is it related to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Are you negligent in your prayers? Are you negligent in fasting, in zakat, in your financial obligations? Are you negligent? Is Hajj fard upon you, and have you not made that intention? Have you not thought about doing Hajj? Are you neglecting your duties to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or are you neglecting your duties to other people? Are you neglecting your duties to your parents, to your wives, your husbands, to your children? As a parent, as a mother or a father, are you neglecting your duties to your children, your neighbors, your friends, those around you, or even yourself? Are you neglecting your responsibilities and your duties to yourself? Why? Because قُوْ أَنفُسَكُمْ وَأَهْلِيكُمْ نَارًا. Your first responsibility is to protect yourself from the hellfire and then your family. So are you neglecting your duties to Allah, or is it something that are you... Unless you're absolutely perfect and you feel that you have never made a mistake in your life and you feel that there's nothing that you need to change, in that case, then I think you'd be more than free to actually stand up and walk away and go from here. But the fact is that I think every one of us, when we look deep down, will realize that there are certain things where we need to actually make that change. You know, is it, that was just duties and responsibilities. In terms of vices, is there something, some kind of vice that you're involved in? You know, is it haram relations? Is it drinking? Is it gambling? Is it anything else? Is there some kind of vice that you're involved in that you need to stop and you need to walk away from? What is it? The biggest thing, the biggest factor in making that change is actually realizing that you need to make that change. Until you don't realize that, you won't. This is why it's part of these fundamental conditions of tawbah as well. What is the first one? Just stop doing what you're doing. You won't be able to repent if you don't stop. And then the second one, realize that what you're doing is wrong and be ashamed. This is where many people will struggle. Realistically, I mean, the whole point of us sitting here is for us to actually go away from here with having learned a lesson, and for us to have something to actually take away and to work on. Right? So I want this to be a practical session where you actually, we walk away with something, with a target, we set a target for ourselves and our minds, we actually walk away working towards something. There will be something there. The biggest problem is actually that realization. This is where, you know, the shaitan, he has different ways of attacking. His attack is multidimensional. One of those ways of attacking is, for example, he will help you in your mind justify whatever you're doing, even though it's wrong. He'll help you justify that. It doesn't matter. Doesn't matter if that money is, you know, it doesn't matter if you're having to lie to get that money, it's fine, it's, you know, there's nothing wrong with it. As long as no one finds out, it's okay. You know, as long as you're not, you know, if you're not cheating, if you're cheating the system, you're not teaching a you're not cheating a person, it's okay. You know, if you're defrauding a company, those insurance companies have bags of money anyway, go and defraud them as much as you want, do what you want. Right? You defraud the system, there's nothing wrong with that, it's not person. These, you know, and those are just simple examples that are more common. But to the extent that he will even justify for you purchasing and selling drugs, you know, using them, alcohol, gambling, all of these things, illicit relations, he will justify them for you. And that's one of his, you know, that's one of his biggest tools. And he's able to whisper into your mind and, you know, try to justify these things in your mind. It's actually walking away from that justification. You know, and it's realizing that no, you're not in complete control of your own life. Other people have rights over you as well. It's a matter of realizing, you know, for the younger audience, it's a matter of realizing that, you know, that slamming the door closed in front of your parents is a mark of disrespect. It's actually realizing it's not your right. That if they're telling you off over something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the power to do, then that is their right. It's actually making that realization. This is the biggest point. If there's something that you can walk away with today, is the fact that actually try to realize, make that realization that you're wrong. And this is why, this is the act of muhasaba. You know, in the language of the Sufiya, this is muhasaba, holding yourself to account. And what do the Sufiya say? Hold yourself to account before Allah holds you to account. And I've said this on many occasions as well. It only takes a moment. If I was to tell you all to do this now, a practical demonstration, or, you know, actually do this practically now, stop for a moment, pause for a couple of seconds, think about your last 24 hours from yesterday afternoon to today afternoon. In those 24 hours, has there been anything small or big, anything at all that you have done that could have displeased Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? That's all it takes, that moment of reflection. Literally, those couple of seconds would have been enough. If there was something there, it will come into your heart and mind. It's a matter of moments. If you're able to do that and free yourself of that, then your tawbah, your repentance will be sincere. You'll be able to make that sincere change and actually walk away from things. But if you can't do that, then you know, you're struggling. Then you need to actually work on that particular aspect itself of realizing what your mistakes are and actually understanding that you're not infallible. You're not infallible and you are prone to mistakes. Those are the three conditions when it's related to Allah. So for example, what does it mean, related to Allah? If you missed your prayer, your zakat, your fasting, so on and so on. Rights which you owe to Allah. But if you owe those rights, if it's something related to another person, then there's a fourth condition as well. These three conditions, and also that you actually free yourself, you absolve yourself of your responsibility to that other person. What does that mean? If you've stolen from somebody, return that stolen property. Make amends. If you've taken something from somebody, give it back to them. If you've hurt them, harmed them in any way, go and apologize for that. Make amends. If it's something that you can replace, replace it. If not, seek forgiveness from that person. If you've done ghibah, if you've been backbiting, go and tell them and make amends and apologize. Until that's not done, Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says that your tawbah will not be acceptable. And so this is another thing as well. Islam is all about making amends. And there's a narration regarding previous nations. In fact, under the commentary of Surah Yunus, I believe, some of the commentators have mentioned that those people, they saw the signs of Allah's punishment and they decided to repent. They went out, the elderly, the children, the women, everyone, they all went out into the wilderness and they begged and pleaded with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then someone amongst them said, until you don't make amends for what you've done, you will not be forgiven. And the narration of Allah, they actually went back. And if somebody had stolen a brick from someone and used it in the foundations of his home, he knocked down that wall of his home and he dug up those foundations and he pulled out that brick and he went and gave it back to them. What was the result of this? That collective punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that had become, you know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had decreed for them, that decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was revoked. Allah revoked that decree. And they were saved and protected from that collective punishment that had been decreed for them. So make amends. That's another thing that we don't realize. But based on, I'm going to narrate to you one hadith and inshallah just talk to you around that one hadith and then finish off today's discussion. And that hadith is a very famous hadith. It's narrated by Imam Nawawi rahimahullah ta'ala in his chapter on Tawbah as well. And the fact is, you know, if you have a look at those ahadith in that chapter, it's very easily available, readily available, Riyadhus Salihin. Second chapter is chapter on Tawbah. Look it up. You know, in terms of this particular chapter on Tawbah, I believe there's about 18 or 19 lectures that we did some time ago on Riyadhus Salihin, which have been uploaded onto YouTube. So you can actually go there and listen to those lectures. It'll be this chapter on Tawbah will have been covered in those lectures. And the fact is that, you know, the vastness of this concept of Tawbah and repentance, forgiveness, is such that the Prophet ﷺ says, giving an example, that a person, he's traveling through the wilderness and he stops and takes a rest. His camel or his horse, whatever, his animal, which has all his provisions on it, manages to break free and runs away. He's miles and miles from any other person, doesn't have any food, doesn't have any water, almost certain to die, and he lays down, closes his eyes, waiting for death, and all of a sudden, he opens his eyes to find that miraculously, his camel, his horse has come back to him. All his provisions have come back to him. Imagine how pleased he will be, a new lease of life. He's so happy and he's so pleased that out of joy, he speaks and he mixes up his words by mistake. Instead of saying, "O Allah, I am your servant and you are my master," he says, "Allahumma anta abdi wa ana rabbuk." He says, "O Allah, you are my servant and I am your master." Not out of disbelief, but out of sheer joy and emotions, he's lost control of his words and his tongue. And he's mixed up his words. That's how happy he is. The Prophet said that when one of you makes sincere tawbah and repents, Allah is even happier than that. Allah is more pleased. Now, what is, you know, happiness and joy, these are emotions that we experience in relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that happiness and joy is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessing that person with his mercy and His rahmah. Allah does not, you know, He doesn't experience bodily, He doesn't have bodily form, doesn't experience any bodily functions or emotion. But that's Allah blessing that person with His mercy. So that one hadith that I'm going to narrate to you, what is it? And I'm certain that most of you will have heard that hadith before. But one thing is, that this is one thing about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about the Quran, and then about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that you could have heard something or a hadith 100 times, 1,000 times, but every time you study it, you listen to it, and even, you know, today for me, there's certain things while I was studying, while I was preparing and thinking about what I was going to talk about, while I was looking at these hadith, and I find this very often. You know, I've studied something, I've taught it several times, dozens of times, and then I've read it again, and something new has come into my mind. Every time something new has come into my mind. And so this is the beauty of the Quran, the beauty of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that every single time you will find something there. There'll be something in it for you. But even if there isn't, you listen to it with love and affection because of that association with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because you know that these are words that were uttered by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so this hadith is narrated by Sayyidina Abu Sa'id Al-Khudri radiallahu ta'ala. Somebody, his brief biography we did a few days ago in our lecture that we have at Asr. So I'm not going to go through that again. But what does he say? He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, in those people before you, there was a person, قَتَلَ تِسْعَةً وَتِسْعِينَ نَفْسًا. He killed 99 people. Hands up if you heard this before. I'm sure most of you have heard it. But I want you to listen to this because inshallah you will pick up something different. So, he killed 99 people. فَسَأَلَ أَنْ He questioned people, he asked people, who's the most knowledgeable people, who's the most learned person around here? And so, فَدُلَّ عَلَىٰ رَاهِبٍ he was directed towards a worshipper, a monk, not a priest, not a scholar, but a monk, a worshipper. And so, he said to him, he said, I've killed 99 people. Can I do tawbah? Will my tawbah be accepted? Is there any tawbah for me? فَقَالَ لَا. He said, no, there's no tawbah for me. فَقَتَلَهُ So he killed him. فَكَمَّلَ بِهِ مِئَةً And he completed by killing him 100 people. He now killed 100 people. ثُمَّ سَأَلَ Then he asked again, who is the most knowledgeable person around? This time, someone indicated him towards فَدُلَّ عَلَىٰ رَجُلٍ عَالِمٍ This time, he was indicated towards a scholar, not a worshipper. And فَقَالَ And this is the difference. The commentators who've commented on this hadith, they say that's the difference between a worshipper, or one of the differences between a worshipper and a scholar. The worshipper, because he gave his fatwa, his decree, without ilm, without knowledge, not only did he kill him, not only did he jeopardize the other person, but he had himself killed as well. Right? So he was killed, and he put the other person in even more trouble that now he'd killed 100 people. The alim, on the other hand, because he gave his fatwa through his knowledge, he was able to save himself, and he was able to save the other one. Right? So this is an interpretation of that hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا That people, there will come a time when people of knowledge will be lifted. In other words, people of knowledge will be lifted from the earth, and then people will go to others who don't have knowledge, and they will give fatwa without knowledge. فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا They will be misguided, and they will misguide others. That's an example of that without the knowledge, he gave that decree, that fatwa, and he killed him as well, and landed himself in more trouble. But the alim, what did he say to him? He said, is there any tawbah for me? And he said, na'am, yes. وَمَنْ يَحُولُ بَيْنَهُ وَبَيْنَ التَّوْبَةِ Who can come between you and between tawbah? Repenting from Allah. This is between you and Allah. انطلق الى ارض كذا وكذا. Go to such and such a land. And you know what the ulama have said? Which land he was sent to? Sham. Land of Sham. The ulama said that this, in the hadith it just says, ila ardi kaza wa kaza. Go to such and such a land. There's no name mentioned. But the ulama, the scholars, they've said that this is the land of Sham. Those who've commented on this. And they've even said, given the name of Imam Tabrani, he's narrated that it's a land of Sham, and even narrated the city and the locality as well. Basra and locality in Basra, he's told to go there. And why? He explained to him, he said, فَإِنَّ بِهَا أُنَاسًا يَعْبُدُونَ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى فَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ مَعْهُ. There are people there who are constantly worshipping Allah. Go and worship Allah with them. وَلَا تَرْجِعْ إِلَىٰ أَرْضِكَ. Don't come back to your land. Don't come back here. فَإِنَّهَا أَرْضُ سُوءٍ. Because it is a bad, an evil land. What if someone asked the question, well, he was asking that person who was living in that land, he's a man of knowledge, and he's saying to him, don't come back, this is an evil land. And he's staying there himself. Right? So if you think about that, the fact is, the land itself is never evil. It's the people in there, but again, it's the association, it's the link with him and his killing spree with that land. So, one of these things, and this is where we left off yesterday's darsa, asr time. What did I say? That hadith, the Prophet said, good company is like a merchant who trades in fragrance. If he doesn't give you any fragrance, as long as you're there in his company, you will still have the pleasure of smelling that beautiful fragrance. Bad company is like the workshop of a blacksmith. If it doesn't burn your clothes, if it doesn't tarnish your clothes, while you're there, you will still have to put up with the horrid smell and the smoke of his workshop. So this is it. Distancing yourself from the company that you hold. If the company that you hold is going to be leading, you know that those are people, they're going to weaken your resolve. They're going to lead you back into whatever sin you're trying to leave. Right? They're going to lead you back into whatever lifestyle you're trying to get back into. They're one of the practical measures that you can take is to distance yourself from that company. And this is extremely, extremely important. I've seen so many people. I'm quite certain that many of you will have actually physically seen many people who've tried to pull themselves away from something and they've been dragged back in because of their company. So this is extremely important, and this is what we learn from this hadith. That what did the scholar say to him? His advice was, go. Not just leave the company of those evil, the evil company that he had in the land. It wasn't the land that was evil, that's evident because he was living there himself. But that association that he had with that land, the company that he had there, the reminders that he'll keep on getting. So anybody in that situation today, whatever it is, if you're going to be in company that's going to keep reminding you of that lifestyle, it's going to keep bringing up these things, it's not just the company. The surroundings as well. If they're going to keep reminding you of that lifestyle, then you need to leave them behind and you need to move on. And adopt different company and different surroundings. So both of those things, company and surroundings, both have an effect. And that's what he did. He pulled him out of that company, out of those surroundings, and said, go and go. Then thirdly, so not only pulling yourself out of that company and those surroundings, but also then putting yourself into company that's going to keep you occupied in good things. People who are going to encourage you to do good things. Adopting their company. staying with them, joining them in their ventures. And so this is a key part of this change. You know, when you said time for a change, well, this is a key part of that change. Walk away from whatever it is, leave that company, change your surroundings, and take up the company of those that are good. Why do you find that in the month of Ramadan, you know, things become easier for you? Because the company and the surroundings change. Everybody around you is involved in the same act of worship that you are in. It gives you inspiration and encouragement. So use that as an example if you like. But looking at how ready Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is to forgive, that person then went off towards that land. And the hadith mentions he was halfway there, atahul maut, and he died. Allah sent two angels came down, angels of mercy and angels of punishment. And they started arguing with each other. Now this is extremely important. Going back to that original point of how ready Allah is to forgive and His mercy, calling out to people. The angel of punishment, he said, the angel of forgiveness, he said he was going to make tawbah. He was on his way to make tawbah. The angel of punishment, he said, إِنَّهُ لَمْ يَعْمَلْ خَيْرًا قَطُّ. That translates, he has never done a single good deed in his life ever. That not only had he killed 100 people, but he'd never done anything good in his entire life. And the angel is saying, why? Why should he be forgiven? He's killed 100 people, never done anything good in his life. Qattu means ever. Never done anything good in his life. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then sent a third angel in the form of a human. Fi surati adamiyyin. That's important as well. Why did Allah send that angel in, the third angel, the judge, why did he come in the form of a human? That is teaching sulh and rectification between people, that this is the standard of the human. The standard of the human is that he should be the judge in disputes, that he should be the one reconciling. That's one wisdom behind that. And so this person then said to both of them, he said, measure the distance. If he's closer to where he started, deal with him as he started, as a murderer. If he's closer to his destination, deal with him as if he's in that destination and he's been forgiven and he's with those pious people. One other thing that we missed there, the company of the pious. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين. Be with the pious. Yes, it does mean emulate them. But even in the physical company of the pious, there are so many blessings and barakah that you can, there's so much barakah that you can receive. But just finishing this off now, there's a variety of different narrations. One narration says they measured the distance and he was closer to his destination and so he was forgiven. All of these narrations are from Sahih Bukhari and Sahih Muslim. They are all authentic narration, narrated by different people in different words. So one narration says he was closer to his destination. Another narration, وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ فِي الصَّحِيحِ, in a Sahih authentic riwayah of Muslim, says, فَكَانَ إِلَى الْقَرْيَةِ الصَّالِحَةِ أَقْرَبُ بِشِبْرٍ. He was closer by one hand span to the land where he was going. فَجُعِلَ مِنْ أَهْلِهَا, and so he was made one of them. So just by one hand span. In another narration, وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ فِي الصَّحِيحِ, again, a sound, authentic narration. فَأَوْحَى اللَّهُ تَعَالَى إِلَىٰ هَذِهِ أَن تَبَاعِدِي وَإِلَىٰ هَذِهِ أَن تَقْرِبِي. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded the earth from where he'd set off. He was actually closer to his origin. His destination was further away. And Allah commanded that land to shrink. And from the other side, Allah commanded it to expand. Or so he was closer to his than his destination. Why? May Allah look at the arrangements that are being made to forgive him. That's the point to look at and the point to know. And in one narration, وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ, in one narration it mentions that he died and he fell down on his side and he happened to roll over. He was right in the middle. He didn't happen to roll over. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala arranged it that he rolled over onto his chest and he's closer to that side. Now putting all of those things together, you know, it is for all of us to take whatever lesson we take from it. Look at the Sahaba and their forgiveness. Sayyidina Ka'b bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala, his whole story of forgiveness, I've done that a couple of times, I'm sure some of you will have attended those. If not, again, it's in this chapter on Tawbah, so listen to those lectures of Riyadh al-Saliheen on YouTube and listen to that. It's a very long narration about how he was left behind the Battle of Tabuk, then the 50 days and nights where the Prophet ﷺ commanded everyone that you're not to speak to them, and you know, so such a difficult time. Look at the difficulties that the Sahaba went through. But you know what he did? When his Tawbah was accepted, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and he said, Ya Rasulullah, number one, I want to give away everything that I have in Sadaq. And the Prophet ﷺ said, no, keep some for yourself. Give some, but keep some for yourself. And the other thing, he said, Ya Rasulullah, I was saved from this problem, from this issue, from punishment by Allah, because I did not lie. I told the truth. I went through momentary suffering of 50 days, but Allah's forgiven me. And He's announced my forgiveness in the Quran. The hypocrites who lied, they have been forever been branded as liars and hypocrites, and they've been cursed forever. Allah's protected me from that eternal curse because I was truthful. Ya Rasulullah, I take bay'ah, I pledge on your hand that I will never, for the rest of my life, I will never tell a word of lie. And he didn't. Sayyidina Abu Lubaba, radiallahu ta'ala, right, who was requested by the Yahud of Khaybar, Banu Qurayza, right, when the Prophet laid siege to Banu Qurayza, they requested, they said, let us speak to Abu Lubaba. Because the Prophet ﷺ wanted Sayyidina Sa'd bin Ma'az radiallahu ta'ala to judge in that matter and to give the judgment of what should be done with them. Abu Lubaba radiallahu ta'ala went and they said to Abu Lubaba, they said, should we accept Muhammad's judge? And he indicated with his finger towards his neck saying, don't. You're gonna end up being killed or you're going to be in difficulty, don't. As soon as he did that, he realized his mistake. He realized. So what I'm trying to say to you, Sahaba made mistakes as well. Ka'b bin Malik, he wasn't alone. There were two other Sahaba with him as well. They made mistakes. But look at how they then did Tawbah. What did Abu Lubaba do? Came back to the masjid, had himself tied to one of the pillars of the masjid. Said, I'm not going to go from here until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reveals, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives me. When the Prophet ﷺ came back to Medina, he asked, what's going on? And he was told. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you should have just come to me. You should have just come and asked me for forgiveness. I would have forgiven him. But now that he's made this pledge and he said, I swear by Allah, I'm not going to be untied from here until Allah forgives me, now he must wait. Now he must wait for Allah to communicate his forgiveness. And so for 7 days and nights, he was tied to that pillar. He would be released at Salah, at time of Salah. He would go and pray. Then he would come back and he'd be tied against that pillar again. 7 days and nights. Didn't eat a scrap of food. Didn't drink a single drop of water. And eventually he fainted. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed his forgiveness in the Quran. And then the Prophet ﷺ, some of the Sahaba went. They said, they gave him Mubarak. They said, congratulations, you've been forgiven. And he said, no, don't untie me from here. This is the love that the Sahaba shared and that the compassion that they enjoyed of the Prophet ﷺ as well. He said, leave me. I'm only going to go from here if the Prophet ﷺ himself comes and unties me. Then I'll be absolutely certain that the Prophet ﷺ is no longer, you know, that is not displeased with me. And so the Prophet ﷺ came and untied him with his own hands and released him. The Sahaba made mistakes as well. Humans make mistakes. The prophets and messengers are infallible. Some others remain protected by Allah. But only the prophets and messengers amongst the humans are infallible. Everyone else, there's still a possibility of mistake. And some of the Sahaba have made mistakes. But look at how they repented. That pillar stands and became known from that day as Ustun Abi Lubaba, the pillar of Abu Lubaba. So, this is it. You know, and going back to those conditions again, finishing off, a couple of things that you've seen. One, the biggest thing that I find, it's that realization. It's, you know, that's the most difficult thing to happen. When people realize, they, you know, you will see that realization take an effect in them. Right? When people realize, it's that realization that made Abu Lubaba tie himself to that pillar and be tied there for a whole week without any food or drink. That was that realization, that realization that I've done something so wrong that I have to make amends. That's the biggest thing, and that's what people struggle with the most. And that's what you need to realize, that you develop that realization. Adopt this practice of muhasaba, of holding yourself to account. And eventually, inshallah, that realization will come. And then you'll be able to make sincere tawbah. Until that point, hold yourself to account. Make tawbah and repent. Do istighfar. And pray to Allah that He give you that realization that gives you the ability to make a true and sincere tawbah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us all and grant us all prosperity in the dunya and the akhirah. Al-Fatiha ila ruhi al-Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار وادخلنا الجنة مع الأبرار يا عزيز يا غفار يا رب العالمين ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا ربنا إنك رؤوف رحيم اللهم يسر أمورنا أمور الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم بلغ مقاصدنا مقاصد الدين والدنيا والآخرة اللهم حصل مرادنا مراد الدين والدنيا والآخرة وصلى الله تعالى على خير خلقه محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين